Hello, everyone, and this is my prediction show for WWE Fastlane 2017. This is obviously also the final pay-per-view that they are doing before WrestleMania this year. This one's going to be a full-on Raw brand pay-per-view where Elimination Chamber was only SmackDown. Now they're doing Raw brand, and we're back in this whole aspect of, oh, if SmackDown has a pay-per-view within a certain time period before a major pay-per-view, Raw's gotta have it, or Raw has a pay-per-view, so SmackDown has to have one. Are we gonna really be going back to this whole two a month thing again? That is not gonna be good. it's gonna mean a lot of doing things for everything down the line here. But let's get into the prediction show for WWE Fastlane 2017. First of all, I'm doing this a little bit differently. Last couple times that I've been doing this, especially with with Royal Rumble and with Elimination Chamber as well, that this whole aspect of betting odds is coming out now. Like, if you haven't known for the longest time, like UK sites and a bunch of other sites, I say a lot. I need to stop that. I need to try to not do that so much. I need to work on that. And then I go off and say it again. But a lot of those sites do betting for the WWE matches on the pay-per-views, not for Raw or anything like that. It's just for ones that they can actually have announced matches or more announced matches and everything in that sense. But in most of the times, their betting odds are right with the winners and everything to go along with it. So I've been looking at that stuff and kind of basing my predictions off of that. You know what? I decided this time around to say, screw it. Let's not go that route. Let's just, you know, look at the storylines, see where they're going to go with everything, and see how they're going to make everything work out here in the end, and kind of predict it naturally instead of like looking and say, oh, they're saying this. No, let's just predict it naturally and see how everything goes. So we're going to start off with a kickoff show here, and it's going to be Cruiserweight Tag Team action with Rich Swann and Akira Tozawa going up against the Brian Kendrick and Noam Dar. First of all, why is this a tag match? This should just be Akira Tozawa versus the Brian Kendrick. I know they probably want to get as many guys in there as possible. I like Rich Swann. I'm a Rich Swann fan in there, but he doesn't need to be in this match. And it's kind of entailing, I guess, two feuds, because now Rich Swann's doing something with Noam Dar and Alicia Fox. And we've seen where they've been going, but that's only been appearing on 205 Live. So if you haven't been watching 205 Live, you're not going to know that in any way. And you have everything you've seen with Akira Tozawa and the Brian Kendrick. That's where most of this focus is. So, you know, you feel like this should kind of be a one-on-one match, first of all. For the terms of predictions here, I'm going with a face team. They, just off of traditions, not just traditions, but just off of what you see a lot of on the kickoff shows, which is the faces usually going over in some way, shape, or form, with the exception of the Royal Rumble. Set of faces won on the Royal Rumble kickoff, but they actually focused more on the heels winning those matches. But I'm going to go with Rich Swann and Akira Tozawa here, mostly because what we've seen on the Akira Tozawa Brian Kendrick side, Kendrick's kind of gotten the advantage over Tozawa for a good chunk of the time here, and it's time for Akira Tozawa, in my mind, to go over in this case. So this leads to the main show itself, which we have, I think, 7 matches on the main show again. Again, we have 7, we have a good chunk of matches here on the main show. You have Sasha Banks going up against Nia Jax. This was just made on Monday night on the whole aspect of, oh, Sasha was going to be in Bayley's corner, so Stephanie McMahon makes a match with her and Nia Jax. I think this is going to be their way of trying to write off Sasha Banks for the show. I believe they're probably going to put Nia Jax over again here in this match, though you could honestly see them having Sasha go over and finally getting one over on Nia Jax. I feel like this match is not going to really serve that purpose in this case. There will be a time that Sasha Banks goes over Nia. I just don't think that night's going to be the night. And it's going to be one of those bits that, yeah, Nia got the pinfall on Monday night over Bayley, but I feel like they're going to continue on with this dominant streak of Nia Jax over Sasha Banks here, and maybe potentially try to injure her before, so she can't be in Bayley's corner at the end of the night. Or they can even do an aspect that, if they really want to go and try to get a more sympathetic side of Bayley going into her match with Charlotte, have Bayley try to come out and help Sasha Banks like after the match or something like that, and have Nia Jax just attack her and try to injure her going into her women's title match. Kind of build up that sympathy for later on in the evening or something in that sense. But I feel like they're going to put Nia Jax over in this particular match again. And they're probably going to be setting up something for later in that night with this match, with the Raw Women's title match later on in the night to go along with it. So my prediction would be Nia Jax in this case. So this leads to the tag team title match, which is going to be Luke Gallows, Karl Anderson going up against Enzo Amore and Big Cass. Big Cass and Enzo, and particularly Enzo recently, has kind of been wearing thin on me. The whole aspect of him being that trash talker and everything, it was endearing for a little while, but like the way that he comes off over the last month or so, he's been more on the annoying side for once. You've actually seen some of the fans are kind of beginning to turn on that when he got bro kicked after a match from Sheamus. You got thank you Sheamus chants from a portion of the crowd. And now, don't get me wrong, I think Enzo and Cass are still wildly over, but it's an aspect that they've never had those tag team titles at any given time, and I think people are kind of starting to stray away from that aspect, that maybe they shouldn't be just a tag team. Maybe, I'm not saying split them up by any stretch of the imagination, but you have Enzo as like the manager and Cass as the singles guy or something in that sense. Also, the one main problem I've had with Enzo and Cass as of late is, you know, their trash talking's kind of the same every single time. It's, you know, same kind of phrases, same kind of everything. Like when you saw him in NXT, they were coming up with creative trash talk and everything in that sense. The other aspect that I have an issue with is that they don't allow the crowd to just go with the SAWFT like they did in NXT. The crowd obviously spells out the word every single time, but Cass also does it too. And why they haven't gone back to that route is like, we have one word to describe you, and then as he is about to spell it out, he just lets the crowd do it to go along with it. I don't know why they haven't gone that route. Gallows and Anderson with the tag team titles, they've kind of been jobbed out over the last month, basically to Roman Reigns. Not in the terms of actually losing matches, Gallows did lose a match to Big Cass on Monday, but they have been kind of semi-jobbed out to Roman Reigns over the last month in a couple of handicap matches where, yeah, they end in DQ, but Roman Reigns gains the advantage at the end and fighting off both of the tag team champions. So I feel like Gallows and Anderson kind of need the win here to solidify them as like legitimate threats with the tag team titles. I'm going to go with Gallows and Anderson in this case. I just see no reason why not to at this point in time. And the way I'm looking at all these matches right now, I am going with a lot of heels tonight with my thought process. So Gallows and Anderson for the tag team title match. This leads into Neville going up against Jack Gallagher. I like the Jack Gallagher character. I think it's great. I think it's fun. Is it time for him to have the title? No. It's not time for him to have that title. And again, it's just an aspect that you just don't believe that it's time to, especially the way that Neville's come off as a heel. He's been really good. His heel promos have been great. Why take the title off of him at this point? I'm going with Neville. I think they're going Neville on this one. And Jack Gallagher, maybe down the line, I think he's getting partially more over than what a lot of the other cruiserweights are. And he'll probably have the title at some point in time, just not at Fastlane. This leads into Sami Zayn going up against Samoa Joe. I've got to go with a heel on this one. There is no way, unless the only way that Samoa Joe doesn't win this match is if it ends in a no contest. That is the only way he doesn't win this match in any way. Or should be the. Or that's the way it even should be. I don't think Samoa Joe should lose his first pay-per-view match within his time in the main roster, especially the way they've been building him since he's come up. There's no way he's losing this match to Sami Zayn. The only thing that you might get out of this one is a no contest. I feel like they're gonna have Samoa Joe go over in this particular match. And just build him more as another monster type character, and we'll see where they go further on along with that as him as the destroyer in Triple H's like Triple H's destroyer and everything to go along with that. But Samoa Joe goes over in this match, and this leads to the Raw Women's Title match with Bayley and Charlotte. We've seen this story before, people. We really have. And are we going to get this story again? There's a piece of me that says, I kind of hope they don't go with the same story, but there's also a piece of me that's going to say, yeah, they're going the same story route here. Now, they do the whole aspect of Nia Jax attacking Bayley beforehand, if she tries to help Sasha in her match against Nia earlier in the night. Okay, you have a sympathy build in there to go along with it and maybe make a WrestleMania moment out of it to go along with. But I'm not, until they actually have Charlotte get beat, or until it's one of the major pay-per-views again, there's no reason to go against Charlotte when it comes to the whole pay-per-view streak right now. I'm gonna go with Charlotte in this case. They're gonna put the women's title back on her. I don't necessarily like the aspect of it being hot potatoed again. I like the aspect of what they were doing with it with Sasha and Charlotte, because it was kind of one person has the advantage on this show, but the other person has the advantage over here. And each time that they would face each other, it became like believable that neither one of them fully had the advantage over one another, and that either one of them could beat each other at any given time. But in this case, doing it with Bayley and Charlotte and doing that aspect again, yeah, you can convey that at some point, but it felt like this time around they should have saved Bayley's big title win for a pay-per-view, and it just didn't. Like I like the moment on Raw that they had with Bayley, the whole Bayley versus Charlotte moment, but I feel like they wasted that moment on a Monday Night Raw where it could have been saved for a much bigger spot to go along with everything. But I'm going with Charlotte until proven otherwise. The only way that I see Bayley keeping this title is like some DQ type thing, which I don't think they're going to do here. I really don't think they're going to do that here in some way, shape, or form of having some kind of DQ or no contest finish with this particular match. I feel like they're just going to have Charlotte go over. They could have an aspect of Sasha, like if they want to do the Sasha heel turn that night, they could do it. Or if they want to garner like more sympathy towards Bayley, like have Bayley try to help out Sasha after her match with Nia. And have Nia go in try to injure Bayley at that point, and that's how like Charlotte kind of gets the advantage for the night or something in that sense. So they need to kind of do something to build Bayley as the sympathetic character a little bit more than they already have. Basically, in this case, and it would be probably a good way to go. And like I said, you can kind of build towards the WrestleMania match to go along with that. So we'll see where they go with everything in this match, but I feel like Charlotte's going over. Up next is Roman Reigns going up against Braun Strowman. Oh man. Oh man, this is good. Like, the program between the two of them has actually been good. But there's this like overwhelming feeling that Braun is only there to feed into, be fed to Roman Reigns. I don't think so. I don't think so. I feel like they're going to set up Roman Reigns' match with The Undertaker. I feel like this is going to be a knockdown, drag out, like, fight between the two of them. I think it's going to be good, especially what we've seen over the last couple of weeks with them in their programs. I feel like this match is going to be a good match. I liked what they've done with Braun Strowman. It's one of those few times where, you know, a lot of, I won't say internet fans, but I'll say a lot of more jaded fans, whenever they see a big guy come in, they kind of get wary about it. It's like, okay, he's going to get a push, but he's not going to be that good or anything to go along with it. And Braun looked like that for a little while, especially in the Wyatt family. But he trimmed himself down. He's crazy athletic, and he's actually kind of good on the microphone to go along with everything. He plays his character up great, and it's just one of those things that I've liked what they've done with Braun Strowman, the way they've booked him. They've made him look like a monster with all those jobber matches and everything. They've made him come off as not like a pure simpleton in the terms of his mic time, but his promos are quick, effective, and kind of conveys him as intelligent to go along with it, and he's gotten to show some athleticism with everything as well in his matches. I feel like they're also going to be setting up more with Roman Reigns and The Undertaker here. I think The Undertaker appears on this show and distracts Roman Reigns to a certain degree to have Braun Strowman go over in this case. And again, I'm going with the heel. I'm going with the heel here because they got to set up for WrestleMania. And this way, Roman doesn't necessarily look weak in taking the loss. Braun gets the win too, and will probably look strong in the match to go along with everything. And you have one more reason for Undertaker and Roman Reigns to actually have their match. I know not a lot of people are necessarily looking forward to that one being the particular match, but it looks like that's the route they're going, especially with the fact that Cena is going to be teaming up with Nikki Bella going up against Miz and Maryse at WrestleMania. At least that's how it looks like at SmackDown. So I feel like Braun Strowman goes over here because of the potential setup for Roman Reigns versus The Undertaker at WrestleMania this year. So again, like, as soon as the main show hit, it's like, I'm picking the heel, and this leads to the final match. And this is going to be an interesting one. The main event of the night, Kevin Owens versus Goldberg. I don't think this match lasts long, first of all. I don't think it lasts any more than 5 minutes, in any way. But you have different facets here to look at now. The way they portray Kevin Owens over the last couple of weeks, especially after turning on Chris Jericho and everything in that sense, they've conveyed him as a person that is a little bit more credible and could potentially take on Goldberg in some way, shape, or form. But you also have the aspect that it's going to be potentially Goldberg versus Lesnar with the Universal title on the line. And you also have the aspect that if they decide not to go that route, then you have Jericho and Owens with the Universal title on the line. I don't think that's going to be the way it goes. I'm going with Goldberg. I'm going with Goldberg on this one, mainly because if they want to have a title on the line with Kevin Owens and Chris Jericho, you do have the U.S. title still there in some way. But I feel like that feud, Jericho and Owens, needs the Universal title. But I feel like they're going to go that route that they want to do, and they're going to probably be putting the Universal title on Brock at WrestleMania. So I feel like Goldberg's going to go over in this case. Like I said, I don't expect the match to last long. in any way. I mean, Goldberg is nearing 50, and his matches to begin with weren't that long as well. So you got to assume that this match between the two of them is not going to last that long. But it'll be interesting to see how everything goes off in this case. I feel I would personally want to see Kevin Owens keep the belt in some way, shape, or form. Maybe not in the terms of winning straight out or clean or anything like that, but in the terms of just winning, keeping the belt to set up Jericho and Owens with the Universal title. You just have Goldberg and Lesnar in a match at the pay-per-view at WrestleMania. But I feel like they're going to put it on Goldberg. They kind of teased this whole aspect of him having a title run and everything in that sense going into WrestleMania this year. So we'll see how they end up playing off. I'm going with Goldberg in this case, and we'll see how everything plays off at the pay-per-view. So that is pretty much all the matches for the Fastlane pay-per-view, and we'll see how everything comes off. I feel like this show, actually looking at the matches, this show actually doesn't look that bad on paper. Like Neville and Jack Gallagher should be fun. If they give it time, it should be fun. Depending on what kind of story they decide to tell with Nia Jax and Sasha Banks, that could be an interesting way of going and can tell story going into the Charlotte Bailey match, which I think w will be a good match as well. Roman Reigns and Braun Strowman is going to be a it's just going to be a fight. Hopefully they just make it look like a fight throughout the entire match. I feel like they've got a good match there, and I liked what they've been doing with Braun Strowman. Sami Zayn, Samoa Joe should be a fun match as well. And Kevin Owens and Goldberg, I don't think it's going to be a long match, but then again, it's a Goldberg match, so you don't expect long when it comes to a Goldberg match. You expect him to hit you. He's back in the back in like 5 minutes. That's what he was in WCW. It was like he'd hit you hard, he'd hit you hard, he'd spear you, jackhammer you. Like I think even Eric Bischoff says, like, and he would be back in the back in 7 minutes, and the crowd was going nuts. That was all he was, but the crowd loved it because he comes off like his entrance, the way he portrays himself, he comes off as that guy's like, that guy is gonna. That guy can kick that guy's ass, and I'm gonna be interested to see how this how this comes out, and whether it's gonna be a longer match or a shorter match or something in that sense. And that's what they did, and that's all Goldberg really was back then. So why change what worked? They tried changing what worked when he did his WWE year run, and hey, what happened? It didn't work. But they've kind of conveyed him as that monster killer type guy who can come out there and he's like, he's gonna hit you, he's gonna hit you, he's gonna spear you, he's gonna jackhammer you, and he's done. And he's in the back. So we'll see how the pay-per-view comes off, and it'll be interesting to see how it ends up playing out in the end. So that is my predictions for WWE Fastlane 2017. I thank you guys for watching, and I hope you have a great day.